Okay, please take your seats so we can start. Very good. Okay, so welcome to everybody. This is a great occasion. It's great to see also the room totally full, which is wonderful. And this is one of my favorite events. This is, we're celebrating the this year's the ICTP Prize, and which was established in 1982 for young scientists from developing countries, and young means under the age of 40. And so it has been given every year, and it's, for me it's particularly special because I was on the awardee side many years ago. And so this year we have two great scientists who were given the prize, and we have them here with us. It's Luis Foà and Hongjun Shan. Luis Foà is from the University of Chile in Santiago, even though he's from Argentina, and Hongjun Shan from the Fudan University in Shanghai in China. So I will say more about them later on, but the prize always every year is given in honor of a big figure in science, in physics in particular. And this year the award is given in honor of Professor Huang, Kun Huang, who passed away 14 years ago. And but he's the, people consider him the father of condensed matter physics in China. And so it's good to honor also him by mentioning him as part of the of this prize, and to recollect a little bit of memories about him and his relationship to ICTP. We have as Elio Tosate here, who knows, who knew him very well, and who knows all the details about how condensed matter has been developing in China, to say a few words. So please, Elio.
Okay, my name is Elio Tosati. I apologize for cold. So the ICTP decided to dedicate this year's ICTP Prize to the memory and figure and the work of Professor Huang Kung. He was actually born 100 years ago, and I understand this is the year in which there will be celebrations in China about him and his contribution. He started off in Beijing, his home place, and then moved on to Europe, Edinburgh first, got a PhD in Bristol. Those of you who know Mike Berry would immediately recognize that everything important took place in Bristol one time or another, and this would fit into his theory. Mm. But then he moved on to Liverpool, and this is where he did the things that made him more famous, collaborating with the famous Max Born, later on Nobel Prize winner, with whom they did several important things that carry also his name, and also wrote this book, which some of us who are diversely young used to keep on their bookshelf for comfort about the theory of phonons. He then moved back to China in 1951, became professor and eventually deputy dean and various other things at Beida, Peking University. Then he became a leading figure in the Chinese Academy of Sciences and founded the Institute of Semiconductors, which he directed until the end of his career. Among the things that carry his name, apart from the book, there is a Born-Huang approximation, which is a variant of the Born-Oppenheimer, Huang scattering from impurities, the Huang Ries factor, when you make an electronic transition that changes the lattice coordinates, the Huang-Picard theory, and several other things. The other things that he did besides science are establishing condensed matter in China, or helping doing that very powerfully, raising generations of Chinese leading scientists and leading contact with the West. His wife was Scottish, and he had a profound knowledge of both worlds, the West and China, and it allowed him to play a very, very important role. To me, in particular, this thing comes as a very impressive memory because I saw him leading the first delegation ever to this place, and for that somebody discovered a fossil find here, which I, with a bit of shame, I'm going to show you because I think it illustrates some of the things now. The shame. Shame later, I hope. That's the Italian TV, 1979. Italian TV,
un
national broadcast.
Un gruppo di cinesi guidato dal vice rettore dell'Università di Pechino, professor Huang, partecipa al Centro di Fisica Teorica di Miramare presso Trieste alle attività estive che quest'anno si articolano in una serie di seminari e gruppi di lavoro dedicati principalmente alla fisica dello stato solido.
Sono convegni
che si avvalgono della partecipazione di scienziati e ricercatori di tutto il mondo. Che significato ha la presenza degli scienziati di varie università e laboratori della Cina? Ne parliamo con il professor Erio Tosatti, uno dei coordinatori dei corsi estivi.
La partecipazione dei cinesi a questo congresso ha un significato molto importante. La Cina, la Repubblica Popolare Cinese, sta uscendo da un grosso periodo
di isolamento.
Noi ce ne siamo accorti ricevendo una delegazione di 7 scienziati che partecipano alle nostre attività estive quest'anno. Sono guidati dal professor Huang, uno scienziato di fama internazionale. Il contributo dei cinesi al nostro simposio e al nostro workshop è stato particolarmente apprezzato nel campo della fisica dei semiconduttori e anche in quello della fisica dei laser e delle proprietà meccaniche dei materiali. Questa partecipazione cinese probabilmente sarà permanente nel futuro e noi siamo molto contenti di questo fatto, che non si era mai verificato prima nel passato.
Quale tipo di contatti sono stati instaurati dalla delegazione cinese con gli scienziati non solo italiani ma anche con quelli di altri paesi che sono presenti qui?
Dei contatti molto buoni e molto cordiali. Qui il Centro di Fisica Teorica ospita scienziati da tutto il mondo, in particolare dai paesi in via di sviluppo, e i scienziati cinesi hanno avuto un ottimo contatto attraverso scambi, seminari e discussioni, e anche a livello direi proprio umano. Per quanto riguarda gli italiani, naturalmente il contatto è stato molto forte qui al centro, ma i cinesi sono andati anche a visitare alcune università italiane sul nostro consiglio, in particolare l'Istituto di Fisica dell'Università di Padova e l'Istituto di Fisica di Milano e anche altri posti, con reciproca soddisfazione, credo.
I think apart from the movie, this illustrates the action of ICTP as a can opener. There have been over the history, over the relatively long time we've been around here, closed communities, closed countries, countries where people could not get out and in. And for some very good reasons, ICTP could act as an opening instrument, so we could get people that could not go other places. And I think this is a rather important action and something of which we're all around here very, very, very proud, and we look forward to doing more of this can opening in the future. Now, thank you very much.
Well, thank you very much, Erio. I can see Erio hasn't changed at all in the last 40 years. The smile is the same. Yeah? Very good. So, let's continue with the next part of the ceremony. So the procedure is that I will just first give the word to Luis and then to Hongjun. I forgot to tell you that we have to do it there because of the photograph, but it's not yet, I will. Okay, so that's so for this year, the prize recognizes their independent contributions to the theoretical advancement of condensed matter physics of modern solid state materials, including low dimensional and nanoscale systems. So for Luis, the theory work by Luis Foà Torres contributed importantly to our understanding of topological insulators, graphene, and two-dimensional materials and nanotubes, including quantum transport and optoelectronics. So for this, I think he received the award, so let's congratulate Luis. Talking to Luis before, he told me that he has been very familiar with ICTP throughout his career. He spent some time here as a participant in conferences, then he was a postdoc for some time, and then he was an associate, so it's a symbol of what connections we have with many scientists in the world, and Luis is a great example that I think we are very proud that he has been attached to ICTP for many years. And now Luis will give his talk. The title is Using Light as a Topological Switch.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon to everybody. I feel really honored to be here and thankful for this prize, and also very thankful to ICTP for the support over all this year throughout my career since I was a PhD student. First conference I came in Europe was here at ICTP. And I'm very happy to be here back to give this talk that it's going to be on using light as a topological switch. I've chosen this topic because I think it's the research line that best reflects what we have been doing over the last few years. But towards the end of the talk, I will also mention other research lines that we are pursuing in Santiago de Chile. So this talk has at its center light-matter interaction. And so to introduce this topic, I would like to use some images from a movie. But it's a famous movie. It's called Wings of Desire. It's directed by Wim Wenders. It's got already a couple of decades. Interestingly, this movie is based on the writings of Rainer Maria Rilke, or at least it's inspired, let's say, at least partially by the writings of Rainer Maria Rilke, who wrote the Duino elegies. Well, he was living very, very close to here in Duino. So this is a photo of Duino in summer. The movie is about angels, and these angels live above the sky in Berlin. And these are immortal beings. They are able to see everything that's going on down on Earth. They are able to hear the people's thoughts, their feelings. They know everything that's going on down on Earth, but they cannot interact with people. And so this thinking about how we use many times light-matter interaction, this reminds me a lot of many of the most of the best techniques we have for characterizing materials for observing phenomena are really using light to observe the phenomena, to characterize the material without changing it. And there are many examples. For me, one of the examples that I prefer the most is Raman spectroscopy. That's impressively useful, especially in graphene-based materials. And this is an example from our own research, a paper we published a few years ago with Victoria, experimental work. This is all experiments done with Victoria in Cordoba a few years ago in Argentina. So this is an example of the kind of techniques where we use light matter interaction to observe phenomena, not to change the material. But as it happens also in this movie, at some point this angel that is characterized by Bruno Ganz decides that he wants something more, so has the desire to come down to Earth and interact with people. So for this, he risks everything. He loses his immortality. And this is right the moment when he's down on Earth. The movie was released in 1987. So the wall was still there, and you can see it there in the background. And you can see the moment when he starts to feel everything. The movie starts to run in color from this point on. Up to this point, it was black and white. And so he's down there on Earth. So our idea would be, what I'm going to convey you today, it's a way of using light, but now to change a property of the material. We would like to use light-matter interaction for active purposes. And in particular, we would like to use light as a topological switch, to be able to switch from a topologically trivial material to a non-trivial one. So as a very first step in this talk, I would like to acknowledge my collaborators. There's a long list. This list is not complete. I apologize for this. But for the topics of this talk, I would like to thank especially Pablo, who was a PhD student with us and is now in Delft, Virginia, who was also a PhD student with us, Victoria, that I mentioned before, Hernán Calvo, who is now a researcher and a professor in Argentina, Stefan Roche, Gonzalo Usag, and Carlos Balseiro in Bariloche, Eric in Valparaíso. So thanks to all of them, big list of people that I cannot mention all of them, and also to the institutions that made our work possible, starting from with the University of Chile, that is a place where I work since 2016, Fondesit, that is our main funding agency, my alma mater, the University of Córdoba, where I did my PhD, and I also worked for 6 years before moving to Chile, CONICET, and of course ICTP, who supported me from my PhD very early years. So the outline of the talk is as follows. I will start with a very brief introduction to topological insulators for those of you who are outside the field, a couple of slides. Then I will turn to how we use light to change the topological properties of a material. I will give a very brief overview of a theoretical framework, a rough idea, and then I will go to an example that will be the case of laser illuminated graphene. And there I will discuss different things like the appearance of chiral edge states, the Hall response associated to these light-induced states. And then I will give some conclusions, and I will briefly mention towards the end a couple of other research lines that we are pursuing in Santiago. So let's start with this. For me, as a condensed matter physicist, the full story of topological states of matter and topological insulators starts with the integer quantum Hall effect. This gentleman, Klaus von Klitzing, discovered in 1980 what we call today the integer quantum Hall effect. At that time, he managed to make some measurements in very carefully prepared samples of 2D electron gases. Today you can just think about graphene, but at that point it was much more difficult. So you had a 2D electron gas with a strong magnetic field perpendicular to it, connected to a source, a drain, where you pass the current through. And perpendicular to this current, you could have other contacts to measure a Hall voltage. With this Hall voltage and the current, one can determine the Hall conductance. And in contrast to the classical case, what turned out to happen is that you have these plateaus that are almost perfect are these plateaus correspond to a quantized Hall response that is essentially an integer multiple of phi squared over h, up to a part in a billion that is kind of a meteorological type of precision, and indeed it is used today for meteorological purposes. And what happens essentially, this was very surprising at that moment, extreme regime of high magnetic field, low temperatures. What happens essentially is that under this strong magnetic field, the sample becomes, the bulk of the sample becomes insulating, and at the edges you get states that move through them as if they were one-way streets, like with these arrows here. And so if you want to produce backscattering, essentially what you would need is to be able to connect one edge to the other, but this to tunnel through, it's exponentially forbidden process because the bulk is essentially insulating. And so that's why this quantization. Doubtless came with a beautiful argument to be able to connect this whole response directly with a topological invariant. And this was really the birth of, for me at least, of these topological arguments. And many years later, 27 years later, this was found in now in materials, similar physics, but now with some differences is what we call today topological insulators. Now the role of the magnetic field is played by spin orbit coupling. And typical plots you have is like this. You have energy dispersion as a function of quasi-momentum. You have in gray the bands that correspond to the bulk states, in color the ones that correspond to the edges. So you see that there are these two states bridging the gap, and they correspond to states that are counterpropagating and spin polarized. So spin up goes in one direction, spin down goes in the opposite. And these states turn out to be very robust, and they happen not only in 2D systems, but also in three-dimensional systems. Three-dimensional systems, it's always a bit more difficult because you have less order for these surface states, but they are there. And this is wonderful playground for studying new physics, but the materials are a bit exotic, and so one would like to expand the prospects for this type of topological states to a broader set of systems and materials. And this is the point when we ask if we can make of any material become topological. And knowing, for example, graphene with such properties would be immediately very useful because we would have would bring all this physics to a material that is relatively easier to handle, and so this would be very, very useful. So there's a full line of research around this that gained momentum over the last few years that generically people speak about Floquet topological insulators. I will come a bit later to the why this Floquet name here. Essentially, the idea is now to use a laser or more generally a time-periodic potential to imitate these properties and to develop states that will be topological. So here, this field, for me at least, was inspired mostly by this paper by Oka and Naoki. It's a PRB of 2009. There was also a paper by Lindner in 2011 where they coined this term Floquet topological insulators. And here there is a very personal selection of papers in this field that expand beyond materials to ultra-cold matter and also photonic crystals. So the idea, as I said, would be to use light as a topological switch. From now on, I will concentrate mostly on graphene. So in the case of graphene, the problem is that you don't even have a bulk gap to start with. So one would need first to create a bulk gap and then to determine if this gap is topologically trivial or not. So there's a lot to do. So the name, this name Floquet topological insulators, comes because Floquet theory is the prevalent theory for dealing with time-periodic potentials. And I will give a brief two-slide overview. It's very simple. What I will do is resort to what you already know. And essentially what I will do is resort to what you already know about Bloch's theorem. So here is Mr. Bloch, that his theorem applies to space-periodic potentials. And in the case of Floquet, I tried to make it as symmetric as possible. So you see I left a white square there because I couldn't find any picture of Messier-Floquet because it's actually an older theorem. And now we use it mostly in the context of time-periodic potentials. And so the idea is that now we have, in the case of Loch, we had a factorization in terms of plane wave times a space-periodic function. In the case of Floquet, when the Hamiltonian is time-periodic, we factorize this in terms of a complex exponential that has a quasi-energy instead of quasi-momentum, and now times what we call the Floquet state. Floquet state is now periodic in time with the same period as the Hamiltonian. And the interesting thing about this simple factorization is that it allows to separate dynamical scales. Essentially, everything that happens in long time scales goes into this complex exponential, and everything that is fast goes into the Floquet states. So taking advantage of this factorization, when you plug this back into the time-dependent Schrödinger equation, you get an effective, you get this equation for the Floquet states that effectively looks like a time-independent Schrödinger equation, but now with this Hamiltonian that is the Floquet Hamiltonian, is a modified operator, and now these Floquet states that depend on two coordinates, space and time. So essentially, it's an eigenvalue problem now in a space that is the direct product of the usual space and the space of time-periodic functions. These functions immediately are essentially a Fourier space, so they are developed by an index, let's say n. So immediately, if you start with, for example, the problem of graphing, you imagine something like this. If you think of the same problem now in terms of this Floquet picture, you have an additional variable, this n, that makes you have replicas for each state of excitation of the time-dependent part of your system, the photon part. So you can have the system with zero photons, plus one photon, minus one photon, or so on. So based on a reference, you have this replica picture space. This is very simple, but it's very useful to think. And with this, you can, there's already a lot of theory for computing topological invariants, for doing transport in these driven systems. I will talk a bit more about this later. So how it comes that we can get a gap in graphing using light? It's very simple. Think of, for example, this is the energy dispersion of graphene, energy projected over one direction in momentum space, and you have this cone. So if I now put on this full replica picture, what you have in Floquet space is now one of these cones for each replica. They are shifted in h bar omega. And so immediately you see that this becomes a bit richer, and there are these crossing points between different replica states. This is, for example, a crossing between 0 and 1. And so at these red points, if you have a proper polarization of your laser, you would introduce a matrix element, and then you would lift the degeneracies and open a gap. This was already proposed in the original paper by Oka and Naoki. We got back to this later on because we wanted to dig farther and understand if this could fit any lab at all, if this could be something that could be feasible in a laboratory. So we were dealing for a while with these kind of things. And this is work we did with Hernán Calvo, who is there in the picture. This is, for example, the one type of calculations we did. This is a time average density of states as a function of the energy. In gray, you see what happens with pristine graphene. In blue, what happens when you turn on the laser. In red, when you put the laser that is now even more intense. And so you can see that there are these gaps developing here at right, the photon energy over 2. That is exactly where you would expect from this construction. Because by symmetry, these red points are half the way between one Dirac cone and the other that are shifted in the photon energy. There's also a small gap developing at the Dirac point that comes because of a virtual process of photon emission and reabsorption. So here, I would like to mention that this range, this scale is not any scale. It's a very precise scale. After dealing with this problem, we realized that there was a sweet spot where you could achieve a sizable gap without at the same time having a power that was too high. And this corresponds to a photon energy on the order of 120 millielectron volts. This is, lies exactly in the mid-infrared. And so the best trade-off for experimental realization of this is something that we proposed was in the mid-infrared. This is very simple physics. A lot of stuff could happen here and ruin this simple picture. Fortunately, this was observed experimentally a couple of years later, not in graphene, but at the surface of a three-dimensional topological insulator. If you think of a three-dimensional topological insulator, the surface states are very much like, have a dispersion very much like in graphene. It's a cone-like dispersion. And what they managed in MIT, the group of Nugedic, is to do a special type of ARPES where they were actually observing these Floquet bands. These lines that are superimposed here in orange correspond to the different Floquet replicas. So impressively, you could see these Floquet replicas in an experiment, and depending on the polarization, you could see the opening or closing of a gap as well there. This was really impressive for us. There are more newer experiments that are even better done by the same group. And so for us, this was a boost because it made us think that we were exploring in the right direction. But then the next question was, are these gaps topologically trivial or not? So experimentally, they were observed. In theory, we were expecting them. But what happens with the topology of these gaps? This is something that we studied in more detail in this paper. And here you can see, again, energy dispersion as a function of quasi-momentum. And here you can see a gap appearing at half the photon energy. So the Dirac point is down here. And you can see these two lines bridging the gap. These are edge states that are chiral. They move like with the arrows that you see there in this diagram. And so effectively, this is a kind of smoking gun that this gap is topologically non-trivial. We did further tests as well. But immediately, we could see that there were a lot of opportunities for tuning. For example, you could change the chirality of these states by changing the laser polarization. You could change the speed, the group velocity of these states by changing the laser power. So these states that are Floquet chiral edge states essentially do two things. They decay towards the bulk of the sample, and they move along the edge. For the decay towards the sample, that is this C here, we found that, interestingly, it turns out to be independent of the material parameters. It's just the photon energy over the amplitude of the electric field. This comes because of cancellation of the Fermi velocity factor that also appears in the gap. We also got some expressions for the group velocity, how it is modified now for these states. This eta is the dimensionless electron-photon coupling strength, so it controls also the group velocity of the states. We got, as well, the first analytical expressions for these kind of states. And this is work with Gonzalo. You can see there in the blackboard, he's happy doing these irradiated graphene things, and Pablo. And so we explored this further. We tested numerically the robustness of these states. They turn out to be robust to different types of defects and perturbations, very much like in the integer quantum Hall effect. So in this sense, a question that one could immediately ask is, in the case of the quantum Hall effect, the Hall conductance is given directly by essentially the number of edge states times mean square over h. And one would could ask, is it the same in this case with driving, with the laser? And this puts us immediately in a bigger problem, because to be able to do a transport calculation, we need to set occupations. And this is a system that is out of equilibrium. So it's tough, in principle, to do it. One would like, ideally, to have the states occupied up to some point, but this is something that we cannot guarantee. And so in the context of these problems, there are two very different and extreme limits. One that I would call it the coherent limit, where you think that the laser is all over the place, and so you will need to take care of dissipation unavoidably. In the opposite regime, that I would call more coherent-like regime, you think that you have a spot that is finite where the laser is there, and then you have your leads that are non-irradiated, and so there you can use thermal occupations, and if you further assume that dissipation is not taking place inside the central part of the illuminated sample, then you can do a very simple scattering picture for this, a Floquet scattering picture. There's a lot of papers on this topic with both in both regimes. But even in the coherent limit, that is the one that seems simpler to deal with, there was a lot of controversy. When we decided to face this problem, there were some predictions that said, well, the Hall conductance will be quantized. with a number that it's essentially given by the number of edge states. And some other people said, no, we don't see any quantization. We do some numerics, and we see an anomalous suppression. So looking a bit farther, we realized that in one of the cases, the calculation was not two-terminal, was multi-terminal, was not multi-terminal, but two-terminal, sorry. And while in the other, it was an analytical calculation for very high frequency. So the photon energy was actually larger than the bandwidth of the system. And so this is very far from the regime where we are interested in. And so the question was really open. So we decided to do full numerical calculation for a system that is multi-terminal, that has a region that is being illuminated using Floquet scattering theory. And to make a long story short, what we found is that actually there are plateaus developing here in the whole conductance or resistance. They are rough. They are not as nice as the plateaus as in the integer quantum Hall effect. And but most interesting, we can now try to check what happens with this number of channels associated to this plateau. We can see here that there is only one channel active. But if I look at the dispersion relation for the same set of parameters, I see that indeed I have more edge states. There's not only one. And looking more carefully numerically, we could see that effectively there were one of these edge states that remained essentially silent. Only one was contributing fully, the other one was silent. And the reason is that in this Floquet picture, you always have a lot of Floquet states that could come from the hybridization between higher order replicas. And these states, although they are there, and you can see them numerically, you can see them analytically, they can be very difficult to excite in this scattering situation. So essentially what you see is that you cannot get into these states, and you have only a subset that is contributing more importantly, at least in the weak electron-photon coupling limit. Interestingly, this problem was addressed very recently in experiments that appear in the archive in November. It's a group in Hamburg, Andrea Cavalieri. They managed to do the experiments in a four-terminal configuration using a laser in the mid-infrared regime once more. And they managed to see this light-induced Hall effect. And everything seems to be reasonable in regards of our prediction. So this was great for us. Very nice to see that this is advancing forward with experiments that are very much needed. And so our message from this is that you could see a rough plateau, but in principle, there are differences with the case of the integer quantum Hall effect. There may be many channels that essentially remain silent. And we also found that there is indeed a hierarchy of these edge states that is very complex. If I had to start over again with this, I would probably not start with the case of graphene. I would start with the simplest system, that is the simplest case of a laser of one-dimensional topological insulator, the Su-Schiffer and Higer model. If you start driving this system, you could see a lot of topological phase transitions that happen. This is work we did with Virginia some time ago, so here is the reference if you are interested in getting into this field. Interestingly, this was observed experimentally, not in ultra-cold matter, as we thought at the beginning, but in photonic crystals by this group in China. It's a collaboration between people in Beijing and the other institute. And so very, very nice experiments. So with this, I will come to my conclusions. I tried to draw a picture of this field that is not as a modern map. It's more like one of these old age maps. It's rough and with many many warnings around. And so I hope that I managed to convey the idea that we can use light to really change the properties of a material, to change the topological properties of it. I talk a bit about the Hall conductance. And there's still a lot to do, especially regarding interactions and dissipation. It's a problem that where there's a lot of stuff to do still. And so I would like to take, these are some references of the works we did in this research line over the last few years. So if you want to take a look at them. So I will just mention briefly two other research lines and I close. One of the other research lines that we are carrying on in Santiago has to do with achieving one-way transport of charge, Bailey, spin, and of course, as well, it could be energy. And for this, what we are doing is trying to achieve this one-way transport by crafting a non-reciprocal band structure in the system. So imagine you could have a band structure where you have states that only move in one direction in a given range and not in the opposite. So this could be very useful for many things. And for this, we are using kind of multi-layer configurations. We like to talk about layertronics, and where the states move only in one direction on each layer. And so this is, I think, very promising idea, although not many people found it that interesting yet. Where we were more lucky was with this other research line that has to do with the search for topological states, but now in systems that have a non-Hermitian term due to either to describe a lifetime due to interactions, or, for example, because it's an effective description and you want to take into account gains and losses, as happens in photonic systems or mechanical systems. And we're looking for topological edge states, topological states in these non-Hermitian systems, and we found something else. We found that non-Hermiticity in some systems could produce that in a lattice that is ordered, it becomes devoid of extended states. That's something that it's really crazy. It shuffles what we know from solid-state physics. And some people more recently call this the non-Hermitian skin effect. And it's a very interesting thing. We wrote a short review that appeared recently on this. There are a couple of papers, more papers that are appearing. This work with Victor Manuel and Eduardo and Matias in Santiago. And so with this, I'd like to thank you again for all this.
Thank you very much, Luis. A very nice talk. Someone may have some questions, please.
That's a very nice talk, thank you. My question is about roughly quantized, you know, mm-hmm. So usually in topology, it's either quantized or it isn't quantized.
Yes.
So you find something that's almost at the quantum. What determines the order of magnitude of the deviation from the quantum? And is it looked random, but I presume it's not really random, is it?
It's a very, very good question. Actually, what happens here is that in this configuration that we are studying, you have a spot, a laser spot, so you have a frontier between the irradiated and the non-irradiated region. So immediately, this puts you some problems in the contacts, because it's like intrinsically, even if it is the same material, you start to have problems because of these contacts. And also, you start having problems because in the weak coupling regime, where when the intensity of the laser is small, then the picture looks kind of pristine. But as soon as you start increasing a little bit the intensity that typically you need to do in numerics to be able to fit this in a reasonable system size, you start to have contributions from higher order processes. And so these start to put some dirt all over in your nice plateau. And so it's very complicated, I would say.
Good. More questions?
Thanks, very nice talk. Normally, when we think about light irradiation, we tend to think as taking a reference, which is the non-excited reference, and then build this excited state as excitations from it. How would you see this kind of situation that it is clearly beyond that picture? How can you reconcile it with that kind of a picture?
Okay, if I get correctly, you are essentially asking about the difference between the really quantum version of the problem and this Floquet version. In the really quantum version, you get a lower, always the spectrum is bounded from below. In this case, not, because we are using a kind of semi-classical approximation where we replace really the field by a term in the Hamiltonian that has a well-defined amplitude and a phase. And so in this sense, it's at the end, both pictures match in the limit where you have a very strongly excited system. So you are in the limit where you have many photons in your system.
Other questions?
One there.
Yes, please, sorry.
Perhaps I just did not understand. When you have the intense light shining on the graphene, you have these one-way edges. What determines the way?
Great. Very, very good question. It's determined essentially by the laser polarization.
Okay,
because
so
all the time here, it's crucial to have, in order to have this chirality, you need to break time reversal symmetry.
Right.
So you use a circularly polarized light. And this, the fact, this polarization determines the chirality of the states.
So it's circularly polarized light.
Exactly.
So then
you can
does
change.
That make it like this turn insulators that have broken time reversal symmetry?
Very good question as well. Here, for graphene, it's necessary to break time reversal to have non-trivial properties. But I could go to other materials, and there I could have different floquet topological phases that preserve time reversal symmetry, with time reversal symmetry that is preserved.
Oh,
and there
okay.
You go to a different class. It's wonderful physics as well.
Very good. No more questions? Let me ask you something totally from a total outsider. Do you see any potential applications of this?
Well, it's difficult to tell for the moment. I would say that we are very excited to see that this finally got inside the lab. Many people start to speak about tailoring the properties of a system on demand, now using the radiation. The truth is that at this point now, it's difficult still because it's very, very tough setup. Few laboratories in the world can do it. But I think that we are in a very interesting way, in a way of using light now for very active purpose. And who knows, maybe one day we get applications out of this physics.
Okay, well, so let's thank Luis again.
It was a very...
Okay, so let's go to the final part of the ceremony. So we're going to call Hongjun Xiang. He developed first principles-based computational methods addressing a vast variety of problems, including low-dimensional materials and multiferroics, where his approach has become a standard in the field. So I'm very pleased to give the award to Hongjun Xiang. Okay, so, and then Hongjun will give a presentation. The title will be Theoretical Stories on New Mechanisms of Ferroelectricity and Multiferroicity.
Okay. First, I would like to thank the ICTP Prize Selection Committee for the support. And also, I would like to thank the organizer of the Total Energy Workshop for the invitation. Today, I will talk about theoretical studies on new mechanisms of free electricity and multiplexities. Before that, I also would like to acknowledge the long-term collaboration with Professor Xiang Gong and also my former postdoc advisor, Su Hawei, and Mark Wangbo, and also my PhD advisor, Jin Longyang from USTC. This work I will talk about was also in collaboration with some other peoples, including my postdoc, my PhD students, and also Professor Lorna Blesch and Dr. Young from University of Arkansas, and Professor Hockey Yinegas from NIST, and Dr. Huang and Professor Erjun Kan from Nanjing University of Science and Technology, and also Professor Picazzi from Spain, and also the funding and supporting agencies. Here's the outline of my talk. First, I will give a brief introduction to free electricity and multiplexity. And then I will describe several unusual mechanisms of free electricity. First, I will describe the model, the unified polarization model for spin order induced free electricity. And also, we found that the free electricity can also be enhanced by the octahedral rotation rather than be suppressed by the octahedral rotation. I will also discuss the free electricity due to the coexistence of orbit order and the charge order. And I will discuss the two-dimensional free electrical systems. Finally, give a brief summary. To start with, let us first take a look at a frame mechanism. I think almost everyone is familiar with the frame mechanism. So in a frame mechanical system, it has a spontaneous magnetization, and also it can be controlled by the external magnetic field. Similarly, in a free electrical system, it has a spontaneous polarization, and the polarization can be controlled by the external electrical field. In a multiflux system, it has the not only magnetization but also polarization. Besides, if there is the magneto-electric coupling, then we can realize the control of magnetization not only by the magnetic field, but also by the electric field, and also we can also realize the realization of the control position by the magnetic field. Free electrics is already has many applications. For example, this kind of capacity, and also the sensors, and also some other applications. For multiflux systems, it may also has many promising applications because of the presence of magneto-electric coupling. It can be used to make electrical write and magnetic read memory. In such kind of device, this material is the multiflux. So if the voltage switch the electrical position, and it also switch the magnetization because of the magnetic coupling. The switch of the magnetization will also switch the magnetization of this part, and then it will affect the resistance of this. So we can read this state by reading the resistance, but we can write the information by applying electrical voltage. So in this way, we don't need any magnetic field. So we can realize low power high density, high speed memories. So both ferroelectrics and multiphorics, they display ferroelasticity. So let us take a look at the mechanism of ferroelasticity. So in the most typical ferroelectric system, for example, barium titanium oxide, the mechanism is due to the covalent bond formation. In such case, at high temperature, in the ferroelectric case, the titanium ion is at the emulsion center. When the temperature is lowered, the titanium ion will move toward one of the nearby oxygen. In this way, the titanium ion can form a bond with the nearby oxygen. It will result in a low energy bonding state and a high energy antibonding state. Because of the titanium d states are empty, then this way, the electron will occupy the low energy bonding state. In this way, the energy, total energy will be lowered. So that's the usual mechanism for the typical ferroelectrics. This kind of mechanism usually requires empty d states or long pairs, for example, a bismuth 3+. However, currently all known multiphorics is not that useful because the performance is not that good. So in order to develop or design high performance multiphorics, we need to discover new ferroelectric mechanisms. One of the mechanism which can induce the ferroelectrics is the spin order. This is because the spin order can break the inversion symmetry of the system. We can consider this this example. For example, this is a one-dimensional case. So if this is a one-dimensional magnetic ion is forming a chain, so the magnetic ion set is the inversion center. However, when the spin order, the spiral spin order is formed, we can see that the inversion center, it is no longer the main center. This is because the spin order breaks the inversion. Because the, if you apply inversion to this spin structure, you will get another spin structure. This spin structure is not the same as this spin structure. So that's why the spin order breaks the inversion symmetry. So in this way, we can, from the symmetry argument, we can understand the mechanism might give rise to a ferroelectric polarization. However, this does not tell us the macroscopic mechanism of spin order induced ferroelasticity, because the electron, the polarization is due to the charge degree of freedom of electron, while the spin is mostly due to the spin degree of freedom of the electron. So they are, seems to, they are not related to each other. So the mechanism of the spin order induced ferroelasticity are complicated and not clear at that time. In recent years, we have proposed a unified polarization model for spin order induced ferroelasticity. So let us consider this spin pair, this simple model. So we have two spin, and then we can express the electric polarization as a function of the spin of two sets. So one set is only consider this the single set term, we call the intra set term, and the other is IJ. They are different. This is both are R. So this the we call the single set, and this we call the intra set term. So if we consider from the spin order interaction, then this term is related to the single ion entropy of the spin interaction. And this pair term is related to the there are other three terms of the spin interactance. For example, the Hertzberg dot product symmetrical exchange, and also the Jamsinski Miramare anti-symmetrical exchange. And also there's another symmetrical anisotropical exchange terms. We can also understand what spin order will give rise to position by considering the coupling between spin and other degree of freedom. So if we consider the spin charge degree of freedom, it means the if the structure itself, crystal structure itself, is fixed, the structure itself has a inversion symmetry. However, if the spin order does not have a inversion symmetry, the spin order will deform the charge density. So the charge density will have no inversion symmetry. So this part, we will call it the pure electronic contribution to the position. And also, there is another term. So the spin order will also deform the crystal structure. So structure might deform. So the arm might move, and the movement of arm might also induce the polarization. So we call this as an ionic displacement contribution to the polarization. And we found there is another term to the polarization. So if because the spin order might also induce strain to the system. So if the system itself is a piezoelectric, then the strain will also give rise to another contribution to the polarization. So we call this as a lattice deformation contribution. So this, all these three kind of contributions are related to, characterized by the parameters. For example, this kind of spin charge coupling, and this is spin phonon coupling terms and spin lattice coupling interaction terms. So in order to make our model useful, so we should be able to calculate this kind of interaction parameters. So to this end, we developed a so-called four-state method. Let us consider the pure electronic part, this coefficients. For example, if we want to calculate the P1, 2, X, Y coefficients of this. So we can consider this four states. So in this four states, the spin of S1 and S2 are different. And the other spin can be chosen to be the same. And then we can derive that the coefficient of this can be written as the polarization of these four states, and then divided by four. So in this way, we can actually calculate all the parameters needed in the unified polarization model. And the four states method can also be used to calculate the other interaction parameters, for example, spin interaction, the J, and also the anti-symmetrical exchange, Jamsinski Miramare interaction terms, and also the spin lattice interactions. And all methods was also adopted by other groups, including Albert Feld and Steven Louis and Spadin. With our model and our method, we can now understand the mechanism of spin order induced phi electricity. For example, in this system, Magnus Adin 2 system, experimentally it found that such kind of a spin order will give rise to a polarization. However, this cannot be explained by the any of the previous models. We found that actually all model can explain the experimental results, and we found this is due to the generalized spin current interactions. And in this another system, this system is a scattering system. But on the magnetic field, the system may order in the ferromagnetic state. This ferromagnetic state will give rise to polarization. However, previous model cannot explain why the ferromagnetic state will give rise to polarization. And we found that actually this is because of the spatial synchronized terms they can and contribute to the polarization. And in the most famous multifaceted system, bismuth iron oxide system, it was known that the polarization, mostly it's due to the bismuth. This is the big one, 3+, is the, has a long pair. However, we actually found that the spin order due to the iron will also contribute to the polarization. Actually, the spin polarization and due to the electrical polarization due to the spin order is in the opposite direction to the anonical contributions. Previously, you was believe that this a spin contribution to the electrical polarization is due to the spin current terms. However, we found that it should be due to the exchange friction, which is have nothing to do with the spin coupling. This spin current term if you require spin coupling. And we also found that actually this system has a very large lattice deformation contribution. Okay, let us turn to the second mechanism. So we found that the felicity can be enhanced by the octahedral rotation. Usually in a particle system, there are several different kinds of instabilities. One is the free electrical instability. So it means that all the carton move along the same direction. And another is the, it means the octahedral rotation. It was usually believed that the rotation compete with the felicity, as demonstrated in one bit's Lanty-Fai papers. However, in 2008, it was found that it was discovered this kind of material, zinc tin oxide. It has the, a large rotation along the 1-1 direction and also a very large electrical polarization also along the 1-1 direction. So this is very unusual because the, this kind of system has low amplitude distance and it has no long pair and it has no hydrogen bond. And as I mentioned, this system has very strong rotation. And after that, actually people also found some other systems. For example, lithium osmium oxide and others, it has a similar behavior. So it also has a felicity and also strong rotations. So we are trying to understand why the system can have very large rotation and very strong felicity. So we first calculated the frequency of the free electrical mode as a function of the rotation amplitude. So I calculated a number of systems. So if we look at this curve, it's for the zinc tin oxide. So we can see that when the rotation is increased, so the frequency of the free electrical mode, so immediately, so it is the immediate frequency. So magnitude of the frequency is increased. This means the increase of the rotation will suppress the free electricity because the if the magnitude of the free electrical mode is large, it means it has large instability. This is the usual behavior. However, if we look at this set, so when the rotation is large, so we can see in this case, so the increase of the rotation will increase the magnitude of the free electrical mode. So this means that the free electrical instability gets enhanced by the rotation. We also consider the coupling between the free electrical mode and the rotation in another way. So we can directly calculate the free electrical amplitude as a function of the rotation amplitude. So similarly to the previous results, so when the rotation is increased initially, the Feilich mode decreases. But when the rotation is really large, and then at this time, then its rotation increases, then it means the Feilich electrical amplitude will be also increased. So we are trying to understand why there is a strange coupling between the Feilich mode and the rotation mode. We used a Landau-like model. So we consider a coupling between the rotation and also the Feilich mode. From our calculation, we found that the coupling between this term is U square, R square terms. This term, the coefficient between before this term is positive. It means that when the rotation is small, this kind of coupling will suppress the felicity. However, we find another term. This is we call the U square and R the fourth term. And we find the coefficient before this term is negative. So it means that when the rotation is large, then this kind of term will enhance the Feilich instability in order to lower the free energy. So this is from the Landau model point of view. So let us consider this problem from the atomic point of view. So if we consider the rotation, the structure, the A set is a zinc. So if there is no rotation, around each zinc arm, we have 12 nearby oxygen. All the zinc oxygen has the same bond length. When there is a rotation around the one direction, the distance between zinc and oxygen is split into different groups. In the plane, so one group, the zinc oxygen distance is decreased, for example, to 2.28 angstrom. And the outer plane oxygen distance between outer plane oxygen and the zinc doesn't change very much. We know that the usual zinc oxygen bond length is about 2.1 angstrom. So in this case, this zinc oxygen bond length is still larger than the usual bond length. It means that the interaction between zinc and this oxygen is mostly attractive. So this attractive interaction will prevent the movement of the zinc out of the plane. So it will pull the zinc in the plane. So this way we can explain why the presence of small rotation will suppress the Feilich instability. However, when the rotation is large, so in this case, if the zinc still in the same plane as the oxygen, so the bond length between zinc and oxygen is very small, it's 1.7, then it will be much smaller than the usual bond length. So this means that the interaction between the oxygen and the zinc, in this case, it becomes repulsive due to the polyrepulsion. In order to reduce the polyrepulsion, the zinc will either move up or move down. In either case, it will induce the local dark moment. And that's the reason why a large rotation will enhance the felicity. We can see that this kind of mechanism actually is a kind of a steric effect. So this is compatible with magnetism. In fact, we predict a room temperature free magnetic modified system with this kind of mechanism. This kind of mechanism also may display unusual pressure effects. Usually, the pressure will suppress the felicity either the TC or the position. However, we found that if the physicist is due to the rotation, then in this case, the physicist must be enhanced by the pressure. This is because the pressure must increase the rotation, and then it will enhance the velocity. Soon after our prediction, the experimental groups in Hong Kong, they confirmed our prediction, and they found this in another similar systems, in Nissan Osmin systems. In the third part, I will talk about the velocity induced by the combined charge order and orbit order. It was known that either charge order or orbit order itself can induce velocity. However, we found that in some case, the single presence of charge order or orbit order cannot give rise to velocity. However, when charge order and orbit order coexist, then it will give rise to multiplicity. This can be understood in this system. If we consider the honeycomb graphene lattice, so the system has an inversion symmetry here, and also has a threefold rotation, and this is a twofold rotation. And if the system as a charge order, for example, it becomes a boron nitride, then the system has lost the inversion symmetry. But still, the system is still non-polar, although it has it don't have inversion symmetry. However, the presence of orbit order, for example, the orbit order like this, then the orbit order will lead to the system resulting a polar symmetry. So this kind of a structure will give rise to a ferroelectricity. Actually, we found such kind of a mechanism, it can be indeed occur in realistic systems. So we found that if we dope electron to chromium, bromium, and then, for example, with lithium. In this case, before electron doping, the chromium is a 3 plus, and the 3 electron occupy the T2G orbitals. However, when there is some doping, so this chromium becomes a 2 plus, and this becomes a 3 plus. So the 2 plus set has 4D electron. Then this is, has the Xiang-Tyler instability. So it will have some charge order and also have some this charge order, and this set has a orbit order. So in this case, it will have this not only charge order but also orbit order. And actually, this kind of combination will give rise to a ferroelectrical, semiconductor, multiphoric systems. So basically, we consider the combination of orbit order and charge order might give rise to a multiphoricity, but also the combination of some other orders may also give rise to multiphoricities. Finally, I will talk about two-dimensional ferroelectricities. So in order to make the device smaller and smaller, because the two-dimensional, this smaller device will consume less energy, and also it has a larger storage abilities. So that's why people are very interested in making and thin and ferroelectric thin films. However, there are some difficulties. First, well-known difficulty is that there is the depolarization field. So if you consider the thin film with the out-plane electric polarization, In this case, the same film, there will be a charge at the surface. This kind of charge will give us to a field. This field will destabilize this dipoles. So we call this kind of field as the depolarizing field. This usually makes the autoplane free electrical is not stable in same frames. And also, there is not an augment. Even for in-plane free electricities, the free electricity in same frames usually also decrease in same frames. This is because the when the size is reduced, then the interaction is cut off. And also, there are some other size effect will also decrease the free electricity. Okay, we consider the perovskite same frames because the most commercial free electrical devices are made of perovskite oxides. To continue, let us introduce the Tonne factor. So the Tonne factor is defined as this. So it means if the A set is large, then means the it will have a large Tonne factor. And if the B set is large, then it has a small Tonne factor. So let us discuss the large Tonne factor case first, and then I will discuss the small Tonne factor case later. For example, if we consider the barium titanium oxide same film, so the barium is very large, so it has a very large Tonne factor. So barium titanium oxide itself, it is free electrical. And we find that in the same film, actually we find besides the usual the fidelity due to the usual free electrical mechanism, this is because the bulk itself is free electrical. But we also find another state. This state is due to the surface, titanium ion. And we found that this surface fidelity has unusual frame and thickness dependence. So this is the usual fidelity mechanism. So we can see that when the thickness decreased, the fidelity it is decreased as usually believed. However, for the surface free electricity, we found that when the same film thickness decreased, the surface free electricity is getting enhanced. Actually, the surface free electricity may also occur in some other systems. The systems, the bulk system, bulk case itself, it is not free electrical, but the same film case can be free electrical. This is because of the surface free electrical mechanism. So we can find that the surface free electrical mechanism, it has nothing to do with the whether the B set has an empty D set or not. So we can use the this kind of mechanism to design modified systems. Let us now consider the a small Tonne factor case. So if the A set is small, it means the Tonne factor is small, then in this case, there will be a rotation of the octahedral rotation. In this way, the A set can interact more with the neighboring oxygens. The most common rotation of the perovskite is the so-called A minus C plus rotation, as shown in this case. So for example, in this calcium tin oxide case, it has such kind of rotation. So when we studied a same frame case, we found that because of the rotation, so A set will have movement. So A set can move along this way, and the neighboring A set will move along the opposite way. So if the same frame case has odd number of A set, then it means that this layers will cancel, but still it has some remaining position. So in this sense, we can call this system as a ferroelectric systems. So in this way, we can understand. So when the thin film is decreased, and if the lambda of the A set of the A layer is odd, then the position will be large when the signal is small. And this kind of free electrical mechanism actually is well known in the literature. In the three-dimensional case, they call the three-dimensional hybrid improper free electricity. And this is because the coupling between the free electrical mode and also the and the rotation, the total rotation mode. Okay. Therefore, in particular case, we find two new free electrical mechanisms. One is due to the surface effect, and another is due to the two-dimensional hybrid improper free electrical mechanism. And in both cases, we found the position might be getting enhanced when the signal is decreased. This is different from the usual dependence. And we also studied another two-dimensional free electric system. So this is the tin-terahertz thin film. So in 2016, the group in Tsinghua University, they grew the tin-terahertz thin film on graphene. And they found an interesting observation. So they found that the TC, the free electric TC of the thin film can be even higher than the bulk TC. So especially the two unit cell or three unit cell or four unit cell case, if they have very high TC, which is even higher than room temperature. In their paper, they explain their experimental results in terms of the defects. So it's a kind of extrinsic mechanism. And they suggest that in the thin film case, they have less defects than bulk. And if the system has a lot of defects, the TC will be decreased because of the defects will screen the double-double induction. And that's why the TC can be decreased. This is their explanation. However, we are interested in answering this question. So how the TC depends on the thin film. If the system has no defects, both in the thin film case and in the bulk case. First, we calculated the energy barrier between the free electrical state and the paraelectrical state of tin-terahertz the thin film as a function of the film thickness. We found an interesting dependence on the film thickness. First, for the 1 UC case, the barrier is small, rather small. However, it is not monotonic. It first increase, then decrease. Because it's well known that the barrier, the energy barrier, is related to the free electrical TC. So this suggests that the TC might also have the similar dependence. Then this will be very different from the what are usually believed in the literature. So we are trying to understand why such kind of system has such kind of unusual dependence of the barrier on the film thickness. So we calculate the first constant of the tin-terahertz thin films. This is the results for different different thin films, and also for different thin atoms, For example, we can cut the first occurrence of this thin atom, and also this thin atom, and also these thin atoms. So if we look at this curve, so this means that this is the surface thin atom, and this is the and this is for the 10 unit cell thin film case, and this is for the surface thin atom and the subsurface and also the inner part. We have some observations. So the surface thin atom has a very small force constant. This means that the surface thin atom will contribute not to the ferroelectric instability compared to the bulk, the inner part. And this will explain why in this region the barrier will get increased when the film thickness is decreased. It's because when thin film is decreased, the surface contribution is getting increased because the ratio of the surface to the of the surface atom is increased. However, then why it is not this way, and then if I also decrease at some point, this is because the actually when the thin film get very thin, we find that the force constant get increased, especially when the thin film is very thin. For example, 2 unit cell and 1 unit cell, the force constant increase a lot. So this is because the actually when the thin film is very thin, and then the system has a very large band gap, and the hybridization becomes very weak. So this can explain this part. Okay, this is the previous this is the results on the energy barrier, and we also estimate the TC by using effective homotonic method. Actually, this was originally developed by the one bit group, and we constructed a homotonia from the DFT calculations. From our Monte Carlo simulation, we found the TC has a similar dependence as the energy barrier. So we found that especially in the, for the Foà UC case, it has a TC which is much higher than the bulk case. So all results suggest that if the defect-free thin film case might have stronger ferroelasticity than three-dimensional defect-free bulk. So this is an intrinsic effects. And this might be important because the, maybe we can make a thin film. And on one hand, we can reduce the size of the device. And on the other hand, we can enhance the ferroelasticity and thus to improve the performance of the device. This is the summary of my talk. Basically, I described some new mechanism for ferroelasticity, and also some of these mechanisms can be used to design multiforics. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Hongjun. It was a very interesting talk. Are there any questions? Well, people think, let me ask myself, when you discuss the increased ferroelectricity by rotations, you say that your model has been tested experimentally. But you pass a little bit fast that part. How quantitative was this test? Right. Yes, so it's very quantitative. So for instance, you can compute the minimum and then how big the rotation is when you start increasing and this kind of things. It can be...
Okay, you mean... We also calculate the ferroelectric position on the pressure. And this is a schematic draw of all resource. But all realistic calculations are similar to this. So in this case, we find that active pressure will increase the rotation. And because the rotation will enhance the velocity. So in this way, the velocity also get enhanced by the pressure.
Mm-hmm.
And incidentally, they measure the TC, our lithium osmium oxide, and on the pressure, and has a similar behavior.
Mm-hmm. Very good. Well, very impressive, very good. Okay, more questions? Okay, so before we finish, there are some refreshments outside that we can all share to celebrate this award. So everybody are welcome to join us outside, except for the winners, because we asked them to stay here for some photo session. And then you're welcome to join. So let's thank and congratulate both of the winners.